What a joy to be in Fort Payne, Alabama with you guys. Let's go all the way back. This is home for you. When was the first time the three of you played on stage together?
In July 4th weekend, 1969, Sunday afternoon. That weekend, me and Teddy went by to visit with Jeff, and we knew he was like a distant cousin, and he had all kind of guitars and amplifiers, and I don't know if Teddy had a guitar or not. I didn't have one at the time.
Uh-huh.
But we sang a little bit, and I'd written this song called Jeannie Brown. Never heard of it, right?
Yeah. No, I hadn't.
Good.
One of the forgettable songs of Alabama, huh?
One of the forgettables, but we thought it was something special. Jeff recorded it. But right after we started singing together, it was special. Sometime during that time, we played in the canyon where the chairlift is, and that's the first time we played in this area. Now, we did a lot of other stuff at the VFWs and parties and stuff like that, but that was the first time.
Did you call yourselves Alabama in the early days? Was that the
moniker? We got called a lot of stuff. We got renamed several times, but no, it was... young country.
It became wild country.
We got wild.
Yeah. Jeff, you're a musician that plays fiddle, guitar, a little keyboard. When did you start playing all this stuff?
Well, I was 13, I think, when I was in my first band. Picked up keyboards. Didn't get the fiddle up till we went to Myrtle Beach, really.
While he was learning the fiddle in Myrtle Beach, we killed several cats over there, you know. The screeching.
That's just plain mean, Teddy. Come on.
About the same time Jeff took up fiddle, I took up clarinet. Nobody, not a lot of people know about this.
I didn't know that.
Well, but I was so bad on clarinet, the band had, I think they hired somebody to break in my car and steal my clarinet about the second week. It was in Myrtle Beach. So that kind of put a quick end to my clarinet playing.
But you played by ear all the way through, didn't you? I mean, you just picked it up and you heard it and played it.
All of us did. None of us read music.
Myrtle Beach was a big part of the Alabama story. Would it be fair to say that Myrtle Beach for you guys was kind of like Hamburg was for the Beatles?
Yeah, I don't know what Hamburg was like to the Beatles. I know what the Myrtle Beach was to us, which was like the toughest, hardest, amazingly difficult nights of playing music. It was like a proving grounds to see if you really made out of the right stuff, so to speak, for the months of the summer, mostly. And then in 76, we left there and went to Illinois and spent that summer up there, got fired up there.
The guy that fired you in Illinois, did he ever say, boy, I was an idiot for doing that?
We don't know and we don't think a lot about it.
Deep down in his heart, if he's still alive, I bet he puts his head on the pillow every night and says he's got to be the dumbest guy
I
that
got
ever.
It.
Oh, no. It was...
I don't think he would.
In those early days, did you ever have to play behind chicken wire?
I did, but I think I was by myself.
I figured, you know, some bands played those bars that were so bad back in the day that they had to be protected.
Well, the thing about the Bowery was is they had a set of waiters there that took care of us. We saw some bad stuff happen there. And one of the things that I think gets left out of the Bowery story is I'd take that poke of tips, worrying about being robbed every night, to my pickup truck and run, sprint, to get to it, afraid that somebody would kill me, and then take it home with me. And, well, everybody knew where I lived, so you worried about somebody wanting a hit, some kind of drugs, wanting to shoot you or get the tips. It never did happen, but all those years, it was pretty scary. Yeah. And we never did slow down. I remember when we went to Texas after we left Myrtle Beach, we played 30 shows in Texas. And a guy with RCA told us, he said, when you get through with Texas, you'll know whether people like you or not. And boy, that was true. We got to Texas, and those clubs, those people were packed out waiting on us. We were like, how did they figure out who we were?
They knew the words.
Yeah, and they knew the words to the songs that we would sing. It's like, this is some club in Texas. And then we did the first big show in Shreveport, and it was sold out, and it's like, wow. They knew, like, we had my homes in Alabama and Tennessee River. And same thing, the head guy with RCA said, when you go across the United States, you'll figure out what people are looking for. I got to tell this thing in the early days. We're playing this club called Chiefs on Piedmont Highway in Greenville, South Carolina. And Jeff is so excited. He's getting to play fiddle on the song I wrote, and we're all jumping around. And this woman, they're out dancing the first part of it, and Jeff hits the little bluegrass part in the fiddle, and people turn around and look at us like, what, y'all are crazy. And so this girl runs up the stage and tells Jeff, "Who? What is that song?" And he's like, "Oh, that's a new song that Randy wrote. You like it?" She's like, "No, that's the worst song I've ever heard in my life."
Can't dance to it.
Luckily, she was wrong. But Jeff was crushed because he was tearing that fiddle up.
We were debuting it, I think.
Yeah.
Was that the first
time? We made a big deal about debuting a new song, and everybody's dancing along for a while, and then all of a sudden, it's like, bluegrass didn't go over too well.
Nobody, I think, will ever fill the legacy of Alabama because you guys transformed the whole genre of country music. I don't guess that was intentional, but it certainly did happen.
We started out to make a living playing music. That was our goal, yeah. Wasn't it? That was our goal. It was like, so we didn't have to have regular jobs,
yeah.
And we could play guitar and sing. We loved it.
If that hadn't have panned out, what would Teddy Gentry be doing now?
Oh, no, I wouldn't have been as happy as I am now. I mean, all I want to do is just play in a band and write songs and go in and record stuff and be part of a band. And I couldn't be happier. And if I wasn't doing this, I wouldn't be as happy as I am right now.
Randy?
Well, let me answer that a different way. I think God intended for me to do what I do.
Mm.
And the reason why I say that, there have been so many moments in my life that I could have done this is wrong. Done this, and I've been done a lot of things wrong, but I think he's had his hand on me.
Hmm.
And I think he probably protected all of us because we're still here. We've had some close calls and airplanes.
As many miles as we've been.
And all the miles that we've been. You want me to tell them the story? Okay, you see Jeff's finger?
Yeah.
Mr. Cook was opening a bottle of wine, and
it exploded.
It's
exploded. And cut his finger, the leaders in his finger. That was in Bowling Green, Kentucky. He had surgery. The doctor repaired it, but Mr. Cook, being the...
Anxious
to get back on and show up people playing guitar and fiddle, did not wait like he's supposed to, so it broke again.
He popped it in two.
He popped it, went all the way...
up here. And
that hurts hearing about it.
And so the first time they sewed it together end to end, the second time they did it. Wrapped it.
So Jeff, show him this. Jeff has to relearn even playing guitar. He plays guitar different with his fingers.
I don't know how he does it.
Well, I don't either, but he had to learn a whole different way of playing guitar.
It's amazing. I promise you that probably 99% of the people out there that would be in that position at the time would have given up and gone home.
Yeah.
Feeling sorry for themselves and went home and said, it's over.
Jeff, I know the last... few years, you've been battling Parkinson's. That's been a real challenge. You still go out there when you can. How tough has it been to not be at 100% and not be able to make it every single night out there?
Well, it's one thing if you quit. It's another if your position gets jerked out from under you.
Mm.
And it's nobody's fault. God's got a reason, I guess.
You know, I know one thing, the Alabama fans love Jeff Cook. And pray for you every single day.
And, you know, Kimo Farias, the guy that plays a lot of Jeff's parts mm-hmm. on stage now, you know, the biggest compliment of all, he said that he would never have took up a guitar if it had not been for Jeff. He said Jeff was his idol growing up. If it weren't for Jeff, he said, I wouldn't be playing guitar today.
You guys have a couple of times thought, this is it, we're going to retire, but you haven't. What's the future?
I think Jeff's an example of, I don't know, you know, I get very angry because Jeff can't be with us.
Yeah.
And I miss that third part. And I'm not sure I want to be around not feeling well and trying to sing songs.
Mm. When I've seen you guys in concert, you still look like you're having fun. I mean, it doesn't look like you're just mailing it in. You go out there and give it all you got. The fans are going wild. Is that a surprise that just the durability of the band and the level of enthusiasm from the fans?
I wish you could have been in Salt Lake.
Was it?
All the shows we've done, probably Saturday night. That's the wildest, most wonderful, sold-out, wonderful audience we've ever played to.
Salt Lake.
Salt Lake City.
What a great satisfaction feeling of knowing that, that people still love our music at this point in their life, you know.
Well, I want to tell you, there are millions of fans across the world who are glad that God put Alabama together for the rest of us to enjoy. Well, those are three of the most talented fellows you're ever going to meet. I really do hope you will visit their museum in Fort Payne, Alabama. It is a lovely community and some great people there. And if you're an Alabama fan, and if you're not, what's wrong with you? This is a fan's delight, I'm telling you. I encourage you to buy their music, support their shows. Everything you need to know about them is online at thealabamaband.com.